2 and 5.
Friends, rejoice!
course, is when I first looked at it. We have time for one more, I believe.
44.
Team fund in my career. To the third Sunday of Advent, and we'll open this morning's service with hymn number 30 in Voices United, Hail to God's Own Anointed.
Thank you.
Okay, today's announcements start again on page 5. We hope you can stay for a time for refreshments following the service downstairs. This Sunday, we are asked to pray for the mission and ministry of the Mount Bridges Charge, consisting of Mount Bridges and Cooks United Church, and for the well-being, compassion, strength, and joy of Beth Parsons and all others involved in the ministry at those churches. You will notice that the Christmas offering envelopes have been placed in the hymn book holders of all the pews this morning. And this is actually a budgeted item that was approved at our last annual meeting. So your gifts will be directed to the general funds. And if you remember from last Sunday, when you told them the general funds need some help. So your gifts will be appreciated. And as you can see by the announcement on the back page, 161 pairs of socks have been donated as of last Sunday. And this is really fantastic. So thank you for your donations, and this project will be ongoing until the end of the year. So and for those of you who were at the Scott Woods concert on Monday night, I'm sure you'll agree it was a great evening. Scott still tells these jokes that he tells every year, but there's a different twist to them, so it's always a guessing game as to what's going to happen. But it was a great show, and in the end, we cleared just a bit over $1,000 for that concert, and I believe there's somewhere close to 140 people in the audience. Your upcoming events are there. Just keep in mind that we are having a Christmas Eve service at 7 o'clock on the 24th. Are there any other announcements? I do have an update on Reverend Larry through a couple of emails. So I believe it was maybe Thursday or towards the end of the week anyway, he was admitted to University Hospital for some major tests that need to be done. So he is going to be there for a few days for these tests. He is on the 7th floor of University Hospital in room 110. He would appreciate some visitors, short visits. And I received another update email from Gwen this morning saying that he had an MRI yesterday afternoon, but they will not know the results until sometime today. So our thoughts and prayers are certainly with Larry and Gwen at this time.
Very good morning to all who have come to worship with us on this, the third Sunday of Advent, where the theme is joy. Somebody remarked that I wasn't wearing any joyful colors this morning, so I look to you to wear those joyful colors, and I see joyful colors all around the sanctuary, so thank you for doing that. The call to worship is printed in the bulletin. Let us come together for the litany of the call. John appeared at the Jordan as a wild prophet.
We have come worried and anxious about the future.
The baptizer was the voice of conscience as he cleansed the people of their sins.
Repentance is a fresh start and help all to new life.
Let us come to the desert where God's justice, peace, and love are offered freely. Please join me for the opening prayer, which we will say together. Come, O come, Emmanuel. Come to the empty-handed and the heavy-hearted. Come to the despairing and the desperate. Bring love to the lowly and hope to the downcast. Teach us your ways that we may save the lost and strengthen the weak. Be born in us that we may live without fear and be confident in our faith. We come with joy that our worship this day may fill us with good things. The Marion Woods and family will be lighting the Advent wreath for the third candle, the pink candle, the candle of joy.
Come now, O God of joy, pour out your Spirit on all who long for your gift of joy.
We celebrate and reflect on your awesomeness. Sunday we'll be lighting the candle of love, which will bring the Advent season more or less to a close. Our next hymn is Herald Sound a Note of Gladness, Voices United, number 28. Today. Number 26 in Voices United, there is an Advent prayer which we are going to say together. Number 26 in Voices United. Or, yes, 26. Let us say this prayerfully. Who are we, O God, that you should come to us? Yet you have visited your people and redeemed us in your Son. As we prepare to celebrate his birth, make our hearts leap for joy at the sound of your word, and move us by your Spirit to bless your wonderful words. We ask this through him whose coming is certain, whose day draws near, even your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. As we turn to Scripture, we find these three passages having the same theme. It is a theme that recurs in Scripture where the writers in the oral tradition, I say writers advisedly because these texts came to us through the oral tradition, the writers slash speakers, if you like, spoke about how God was going to change the world. We pick up the story in the first chapter of Luke and the latter part of that narrative, verses 47 through 55, that part of Scripture which is called the Magnificat, let your name be praised, the Latin for let your name be praised. It is Mary who sings this song. It is a song of wonderment at the grace and power of an almighty God. She begins her song, my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. On a day when we celebrate joy, it is good to begin with Mary's song of joy. For God has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now all generations will call me blessed. This is Mary speaking. For the mighty one has done great things for me. Can you imagine a 14-year-old girl who is pregnant, saying these powerful words. The mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him, not fear in the literal sense, but those who have awe and respect for God from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. Now, this is at the heart of the Magnificat. He has brought down the powerful and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich empty away. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he has made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his descendants forever. That's the end of the Magnificat, a song of Mary. We turn next to the prophecy of Isaiah in the 61st chapter and the first four verses and then verses 8 to 11. Now here is the great prophet saying that God's Spirit is upon him. The Spirit of God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me. He believes that God has anointed him to be a prophet. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed. Now, Mary has followed Isaiah. This is originally what Isaiah said, and Mary followed Isaiah. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives. It's almost exactly what Mary was saying, and released to the prisoners to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, Zion being another name for Jerusalem, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display God's glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. Israel has returned home from exile in Babylon to the ruins of the city of Jerusalem. And so God, through Isaiah, is calling for repairs to the city. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations. Israel, the nation, is now known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord, says Isaiah. My whole being shall exult in my God. For God has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before the nations. Here ends the reading from the prophecy of Isaiah, which speaks of a wonderful time to come in the future. We turn next to the Gospel according to St. John, which we only read on special occasions in the three-year lectionary cycle. This is the year of Luke, and so we are reading John on a special day, a day of joy for the Advent wreath. Hear these words. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, Jesus being the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord.'" As the prophet Isaiah, now here is John quoting from Isaiah. Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Here ends the Gospel according to St. John. Thanks be to God. Let us take a moment for silent prayer. Amen. Bethlehem bound, the choir intoned the words, Bethlehem bound. If this is the year you plan on going to Bethlehem, you must pass through the desert where John is preaching. I'm sure you've heard that before in this season. We can't seem to get rid of John. We can't shake him off. He's back again on the third Sunday of Advent, the Sunday of joy. Maybe it's the camel's hair that covers his entire body. It clings to us. We try to pull away from John, but he clings to us like a magnet. Maybe it's his animal magnetism. Maybe it's the sound of his voice that is so compelling as he beckons us to come and be drowned in the waters of baptism. John's address to our world is that you and I should turn around, alter our lifestyle, start over again. We follow the crowd to the mall, or open our PCs or laptops to download Amazon or some other .com where the prices are lower and the shipping is free. You've heard that? Low prices and free shipping have emerged as economic markers in our cultural world. 800 robots loaded with tons of merchandise ferry the sold items into the hands of workers on assembly lines ready to package them. I am telling you about what is happening at Amazon. You and I are living, my dear ones, in a pre-packaged world where we don't have to worry with what's on the inside. The prophet Isaiah exposes us to another world, one in which you and I come face to face with a massive reversal, a reordering of the powerful social arrangements. The people have debts, and they can't repay them. It's our world at the end of January. I want to push you forward to the end of January, when our mailboxes are stuffed with credit card bills. Isaiah's vision is about how to cancel the cycle of indebtedness. He tells us that God loves justice and hates economic oppression. God has come to correct the sorry state of the people drowning in January's woes. God will intervene to reorder the economic power concretely in a genuine public transformation. The pressure, my dear people, of economic paralysis leads to a loss of hope and to despair. The people are returning from exile in Babylon to rebuild their city. God knows where to find workers to rebuild the city. In Canada, we look around and we say we don't have enough workers to build. God will search among the oppressed, the brokenhearted, the captives, and the prisoners to help rebuild the world. The world is in shambles. The world needs to be rebuilt. Isaiah said that centuries ago, and it's still happening. We still need to rebuild this world. The defeated, the marginalized, and the powerless, those who have been ground down by the economic policies of the empire, will become the new workers. The abused and the oppressed will be restored to well-being, joy, and the security of being employed again. This is not a pious or a religious act. It is how God chooses to break the vicious cycle of the old order. The sound of the trumpet, called the Yabal, Y-A-B-A-L, in Isaiah's prophecy, is a clarion call to the people that God has entered human history in a calculated move to set things right. This move is described by the prophet in political and not spiritual terms. The prophets were the great politicians of that era. They spoke to the people as the politicians should have spoken. Jubilee is God's way of intervening every 50 years to provide amnesty for the enslaved and the imprisoned. It was called Jubilee, and it happened every 50 years when debts were forgiven. Can you imagine a time when all debts are forgiven? A report made public of the actions of the CIA in the US following 9/11 has revealed the massive use of torture. Torture is commonplace all over the world, especially in Guantanamo Bay, where prisoners have been held for many years in violation of the United Nations Declaration on Human Rights. An election promised by a former president to shut down the prison in Guantanamo Bay never realized itself. But what we are seeing today is a gradual awakening to the reality that God's ways may be slowly beginning to take hold. We look back and we think, well, it didn't happen. The story of the joy of the third Sunday of Advent is that it can still happen. And that's why we celebrate today, is that we can't give up. Isaiah's wondrously lyrical poem reveals how new symbols can replace the old, how garlands of flowers can replace the ashes of mourning, how oil can soothe the people's skin. Newness is expressed in the clothing that is worn by the people. My dear ones, Jubilee is a year of reversal, restoration, and restitution. It is an alternative to present social and economic arrangements. Third Isaiah, Isaiah 61, is the prophet of joy, as we in the church mark this day as one of rejoicing. Even though we have lit a pink candle, we know that joy is not the mark of our culture. True joy undermines the frantic activity of the season, the pushing and the shoving in the malls and the shopping centers. True joy shakes us free from a world that controls us by keeping us tired. When the yabal sounds, the signal is given to return property that has been confiscated and expropriated. Jubilee is an act of communal sanity, says one writer. We're living in an insane world, my dear people. Everyone is restored to their proper place in the economy when the yabal sounds, that trumpet. Jubilee is a concrete, material, economic act. Accumulation, acquisitiveness, greed, and monopoly are seen for what they really are. Actions that are contrary to God's will for the people, the utterly destitute who have no one to turn to but God. Mary, the mother of Jesus, in her song called the Magnificat, referred to them as those of low degree who will be exalted. They are the ones who always lose in the market game. Jubilee insists that the poor be let back into the economy, that they be given power and access to goods, that they not be excluded anymore. Jubilee is an act of resistance that refuses to believe that those who die with the most toys win. Isaiah's vision is not about angels flying around in heaven. Rather, it's about God's rule on earth, where justice, mercy, kindness, and peaceableness are part of each day's reality. It is where, says another writer, no one is under threat or risk or danger, where all are safe, valued, honored, and cared for together as neighbors. Jubilee insists that the land we cultivate year after year lie fallow for 1 year so it can renew itself. Where is that happening? That slaves and prisoners be released and foreigners and refugees be reunited with their families. I see signs that that is beginning to happen. To break the cycle of nothingness, nihilism, and despair that characterize the disenfranchised, you and I have a duty to encourage and inspire those who have been the victims of social oppression. The structural evil, evil is like a structure in the society, embodied in organizations like the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund, where structural adjustment programs, or SAPs, structural adjustment programs, nicknamed SAPs, have led directly to the outbreak of contagious diseases like Ebola and the undermining of educational opportunity for children. Isaiah's God and the God of John the Baptist has sent Jesus, who comes not as the baby of piety, but as an abrasive liberator, to empty our prisons and to overturn our debt systems. God's ethics insist that money and property be shared, that prisons no longer be operated for capitalist gain. Isaiah's vision is about the announcement of a whole new order of creation, where the Anawim, the faithful poor, those who depend upon God, will no longer be forced to live in a world where their future has been foreclosed. In the name of the God who created us, the Christ who is always redeeming us, and the Spirit who has now set us free. Amen. Before you with mixed emotions. Guilt intrudes upon our gratitude, and we are moved to confession. Even though we know better, we insist on setting the terms for our relationship with you. We substitute our lineage for your love in drawing the boundaries of our community. We flatter those who praise us, even though they may not praise you. And we recruit you in the service of our mission instead of enlisting ourselves in the service of yours. Deliver us from our double-mindedness, O God, that we may pursue you with the devotion of the shepherds, praise you with the song of the angels, and present you with a gift even greater than the gifts of the wise men, the gift of ourselves. As we offer ourselves upon your altar, dear God, we do so for the sake of your mission and not ours. We are grateful for all those who bear your cross with us. They do not make the task easy, but they do make it easier. So we pray for the increase of laborers in your vineyard. May the coming of Emmanuel so transform the members of Christ's body that you through us shall overcome evil with good, moving the well-fed to care for the ill-fed, the strong to rescue the weak, the devout to commune with the indifferent, the well to minister to the sick, the learned to teach the ignorant, the natives to accept the refugees, and the haves to remember the have-nots. O God, as we await the coming of Christ into the world, we pray for the courage to embrace God's mission into the world. Remember, O God, Larry Schneider, as he is in the hospital now and tests are being done to help him along the way. Remember Claire Humphrey, he has been ailing for a while, and we pray that good health will return to his body. We pray for all those we know who are broken in spirit, in body, and in mind. Remember Sheila Duffin. Remember all those we know to be recovering from surgery. God, you hold them in your care, and we ask your blessing upon them. In the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The hymn, Spirit of God, Descend Upon My Heart, number 378, Voices United.
Thank you.
seated. It has been a vital part of the liturgy and continues to be. The morning offering is a sign and sacrament that we want to become workers in the vineyard of God. Let us return our thanks through these gifts. The morning offering will now be received.
Our Lord, have mercy.
walk with you to the end of your road. May the Christ who serves with a wounded heart teach you to serve one another. May the Christ who loves with a wounded heart be your love forever. When you go out, may you see the face of Jesus in everyone you meet, and may everyone see the face of Jesus in you. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, be ours this day and evermore. Amen. Joyce and Kathleen.